Hello, Cross Kingdom. I'm Paul Krismanitz, and this is your weekly refresher. This week, I talked about imitating Christ. And basically, what I came down to, I titled it Identity Through Imitation. Because Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11:1, he says, "Imitate me, for I imitate Christ." He's talking about how Jesus is his model for how to live. Now, I know that's kind of like a duh moment, but the truth is so many of us don't do that. Instead, what we'll do is we look at the Bible and we pick out phrases we like, we pick out rules that maybe were taught us as kids or even when we first became believers, and we start saying like, this is how I gotta live. But really, it comes down to just living like Jesus. And from there, I felt strongly that John 8 was kind of like a chapter to really deep dive in. Because in John 8, the whole chapter is Jesus interacting with the religious, especially the Pharisees. And he just keeps going back and forth between them, and we get this wonderful dialogue and this wonderful example of the differences between Jesus and his kingdom-mindedness, his knowing who he is as God and royalty versus the religious spirit. You know, the Pharisees, they were supposed to know Jesus. They were supposed to know God better than anybody. They were the religious leaders of the day. And the people looked up to them on how to live. And it was the Pharisees' job to memorize the Old Testament, but also to memorize every law and tradition passed through Judaic culture. And because of this, people looked to them and saw them as the example. Now, we know by that time, the Pharisees had become very full of themselves, and very few of them were legitimately doing it to serve God anymore. In fact, most of them were doing it as a means to just kind of put themselves above people. They'd been puffed up with knowledge, as Scripture says, and they used it in such a way that their hearts had become calloused. So they knew Scripture, they knew history, they knew their religion, but they were supposed to know God, and they didn't. And Jesus constantly hammers them on this, that if you knew me, if you were really from the Father, if you were children of God, you would recognize me, but you don't. And he goes so far as to call them the children of the devil. And that's because religion really is from the devil. It's because God always, always, always meant to be in relationship with us. We can look before the law and we look at Abraham, Moses, Noah, all these amazing people in Scripture, and they all walked out of relationship with God. They didn't even have the law. In Exodus 19 and 20, the law is given to the people as a substitute for relationship. It was never God's plan. And so these people, these Pharisees, these religious Jews, had completely put their faith in law, in religion. And because of that, they missed Jesus. So what does Jesus show us, though, in these times? What did they hate so much about him? They hated how free he was. He wasn't bound to the law. He lived in freedom. Now, guess what? Jesus never broke the law either. That's what's so crazy about this. He says, "Tell me where I've sinned," and they can't name one thing he's done wrong. But still, it was the way he was. He was so free. He wasn't afraid. He was able to just live life, and he did it with a grace. And we know now that it's because he had the Holy Spirit. And guess who else has the Holy Spirit? We do. Jesus went law by law, especially in the Sermon on the Mount, and he breaks down these laws and he said, "But I tell you, it's actually about what goes on in the heart, not what you do externally." So in the New Testament, we actually have a higher standard of living than they had in the Old Testament, than they had with the law. But we have God's Spirit in us now. We are literally, when we say yes to Jesus, he sends us the Holy Spirit. It goes right into our bodies, our souls, and he walks with us now. And because of that grace, we're given the Comforter and the Helper, the Holy Spirit, who guides us into holiness. Now it's actually easier to live better than they lived in the Old Testament when they lived by laws and rules and traditions. Isn't that crazy? I love how God works. He calls us to a higher standard, but then he equips us to do it easier. We know Jesus was perfect, but he looked imperfect to the Pharisees. And when they tried to break it down, they couldn't pinpoint it. They couldn't say why. because he looked so different than what they'd hoped for and expected. And he actually gave them something even better, but they were too dedicated to their religion to see it. Jesus walked with no fear. Sinners loved him because he walked with love. He lived in mercy. He lived with joy. All things that the religious spirit just gets really bent out of shape about. This is what I love about Jesus. He doesn't make his life about following the rules. It tells us over and over again, Jesus was perfect without fault, never sinned. It tells us that plenty of times. But when it talks about Jesus's life, the focus is never on the fact that he didn't sin. It's never, that is not the focus of Jesus's life, because that's not the focus of God with us. God wants us to live abundantly. John 10:10 says, I came to give you life and to give it to you fully or abundantly. That is God's focus. Show us how to live fully. And if we live fully, just like Jesus did, sin won't be an issue. Isn't that amazing? Like, it looks like freedom. It looks like joy. It looks like being expressive and creative and fun. And it looks like being passionate. This is what it looks like. That's what Jesus shows us. And so in John 8, he shows us mercy when he forgives the adulterous woman. He shows us confidence in his identity when he says, I am. And he says, I know exactly who I am. You don't know. He shows us all these things that the religious spirit just is really upset about, because the religious spirit is about keeping us down. It's about control. It's about manipulation and fear. That's what religion is really about. It's about trying to get to God through works, but we can't do that. It's all through relationship, and then the works follow. So I encourage you, as I got encouraged even reading John 8, preparing for the sermon, to just look at Jesus. When you're wondering, how should I live? What should life look like? Look to Jesus. And like Paul says, imitate me because I imitate Christ. Find people who you know love Jesus and have gone after him. Find the people in your sphere of influence, the people that you want to be like because they're doing what you want to do. Find those people who are most like Jesus and imitate them. And that is where you will not only find your identity, it's also where you'll find eventually your originality. That's how God designed it. Isn't that beautiful? Even Jesus looked to the Father and didn't do anything unless he was doing it or said anything without him saying it. Jesus was imitating. It's always identity that comes through imitation. Well, I'm so excited. December's almost here. We're getting ready to go into Christmas. What a better way to imitate Jesus than to give and to be jolly. I can't stress enough how much I love this time of year. So be blessed as we head into this season, and I hope you have a wonderful week and wonderful holidays.